Thank you so very much. Oh my goodness. I am just overwhelmed and overjoyed, Cindy, that you asked me. And I want to thank the Area 74 Conference for inviting me. I sure would have loved to have seen you in person, but I'm so grateful that this is the next best thing. It's been 2 years since I've spoken in Wisconsin. The last time I spoke in Door County in Fish Creek. So I'm just overjoyed to be here with y'all tonight. So I want to go ahead and make amends to David. I see you working so hard there, honey. And I talk fast for all you slow listeners out there. And so buckle up your seatbelts. We're about to go on a ride because I do have an enthusiasm and a passion for this program. And it's because alcoholism is all I've ever known. And this program has helped me one day at a time recover from the seemingly hopeless effects from the family disease of alcoholism. So with that being said, I want to pause just to invite God into this talk because God is the most important thing. My first sponsor said, Catherine, the right order of things is God first, you second, and others third. So I'm just going to have a moment of silence, invite God in. Then my agreement with God is to tell whatever story he would have me to tell, even if it means I look bad. So just a moment. That will be done. Well, thank you again for inviting me. And like I said, my name is Catherine. I'm a grateful member of Al-Anon. My home group is the Preston Al-Anon Family Group in Dallas, Texas. I go to, when we were before lockdown, I went to at least 5 meetings a week. I like to go to Monday, Wednesday, and Friday noon meetings, Saturday mornings at 8:30, and then I moonlight at another local group called the Clean Air Al-Anon Family Group, Tuesday noons and Thursday at 10:30. I love being in the middle of this program. But you know, I'm not from Texas originally. I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana. I grew up in a very fun town where drinking is really part and parcel of just living in that part of the country. And so I grew up in alcoholism. My dad was an everyday drinker. He was a blue collar worker. He was the type of man that would wake up at 4:30 in the morning. He would drink his black coffee. He'd listen to NPR radio. He'd smoke his 2.5 pack a day cigarettes and he would start his day. He'd read his morning paper and then he'd report to work anywhere between 6 and 6:30. He'd work all day long. And then as soon as he was done, he'd never come home and he'd go straight to the bar. And my dad was a wonderful, lovable, predictable drunk. He would just stay at the bar. And of course, there was a time of day when mother would just start getting tight inside. You could just see her restlessness, her irritableness, her discontent. And you could tell that it was around dinner time and she knew dad wasn't home. So she would scream and yell at one of me, either myself or my two sisters, to get up, to get to the phone and call dad and beg him to come home. We would beg him to come home and I said, Dad, please, Mom's getting so mad. Would you please come home? And he'd say, all right, girl, I'll be right there. He'd come home. We'd eat dinner in stone cold silence. No one was ever allowed to talk to him. And my mother told us, well, how would he ever know if he did anything bad? So we ate dinner. It was a very traditional home. The girls cleaned up. Dad went and sat and finished watch TV. He would smoke his cigarettes until they would just burn. You know, he'd have a 2-inch ash on it. And he'd pass out and he'd get up and do one or two things. He'd go pee in the fireplace or the closet and then he'd go to bed. Now, my mother and I were just laughing about this week. She said, you know, your father used to do something very peculiar. He would pee in the fireplace or the closet. And I said, Mom, I tell that story all the time because, you know, that's part of alcoholism. So Dad, you know, because he was passed out drunk and he was a blue collar worker, he was always covered head to toe in grease. He went straight to bed and he never showered. And of course, do I need to tell you, my parents never slept with one another. But as soon as Dad went to bed, my mother was such an angry, rageful person. She would take out all of her anger and rage on me and my sisters. She would line us all up on the couch or stand us straight up against the wall, and she would take our inventory, and she would just read us the riot act. I don't know what my sisters heard, but I know what I heard. She said, you're not good enough. You're not pretty enough. You're not thin enough. You're not smart enough. You're going to have to work twice as hard to be half as good. You're not worth the powder to blow you to hell. And I wish you were never born. And I don't know about any of you, but I heard that over and over again, and all I can describe it to you is what it felt like was a steady soul murder, because everything that you think you know about yourself that's good, wonderful, talented, beautiful, everything just gets ripped out of you. That was the verbal abuse. And then the physical abuse. The physical abuse continued in my family, and the only two ways that stopped was, one, I can outrun it, or two, mom would get tired of hitting you. She was the type of mother that would ask you to go pick the switch off the tree to beat you with. She would break things on you. She would hit you with a spoon, a book, a belt, a tree branch, whatever it was. She would just hit you with whatever she could get her hands on, and that wouldn't stop until she got tired. And so that very much is the family disease of alcoholism. In this family disease, very early on, I learned to run from people, pain, and problems. How did it feel like growing up in this family? Well, I felt ignored, irrelevant, insignificant, invisible, ignorant, and incredibly isolated, because the family disease of alcoholism thrives on three things: denial, keeping secrets, and isolation. And it was that keeping secrets component. I was a person who would walk around acting like I was fine and pretending that I was fine. I became a person who hid tremendous pain behind a mask that they wore. And there's a word for that. It's called an exodontesiast, which means a person who hides behind a fake smile. And that's what I had become. Why? Because communication was not existent. Because alcoholism as a family disease just not only destroys family, but it destroys unity, trust, intimacy, connection, communication, vulnerability, and love in families. And it's not a wonder why this family broke apart, because communication in our household was a one-way street, someone screaming and yelling at you, or it was a roadblock. When someone is so hyper-focused on everything that you did, I was so bottled up, all I could do was freeze all of my emotions, because it was so painful to live in this family system that in order to be safe, I just froze. And what I can share with everyone here today is feelings buried alive, they never die. Because what happens to me later on in life is I became like this anger iceberg. The problem with icebergs is you only see the top 10% of it, but underneath the surface are very deadly, volatile reactions that these are the things that I brought into relationships. Now, let me tell you something. My dad decided to give up the one thing. If this is alcohol, he decided to give up the one thing that was causing the problem. This is what mother is yelling and screaming out. So if dad gives up the alcohol at age 13, I don't know why he did it. You know, I grew up in the capital Catholic of the world. I only have paperwork to say that I'm Catholic only because I almost died when I was born and they baptized me in an instant, but we weren't even the type of Catholic that's went to church on the 2 days you're supposed to, on Christmas and Easter. And so dad decided to give it up one Lenten season, and the next year he gave up smoking, and you would think that the family would be fine, but the family wasn't fine. Why? It's because the weapons of mass destruction that we learned to growing up in this alcoholic family home are, I know how to hate, I know how to hurt, I know how to judge, I know how to criticize, I know how to keep score, I know how to take your inventory, I know how to shame, I know how to guilt you, I know how to use anger as a means to manipulate you, and if all else fails, I'll beat you senseless if you don't do what I want you to do. And violence always worked. It worked in my family, and later in life, all I learned how to do, I know how to live in crisis, and I know how to create a crisis. And I have the blueprint of the family disease of alcoholism, and I don't even know that I'm sick. This skill set would destroy any relationship, regardless, alcoholic or not. And I became a monster finding a monster. So of course this family fell apart, and I'll tell you why. My sister told me when I was about 17 years old, 18 years old, she told me that my mother was cheating on my father. This was the time. I had been keeping score all my life. I've been waiting to enact revenge on my mother to get her back for everything that she ever did to me. My commitment in this world was to make her life miserable ever since she beat me and tried to destroy me. I mean, ever since I was little, my mother, she just couldn't stop hurting us. And that's one of the things that we say in Al-Anon. It's from one of our books, Survival to Recovery. Hurt people hurt other people. And so when I found out my mother was having an affair, I decided to call a family meeting and make it my business to report her behavior to my father. And what I would say to you is I was always living on that road to revenge. But if you decide to walk on that road to revenge, you be sure to dig two graves, because that's going to wind up killing you. So I called a family meeting. My mother was not invited to this meeting. Why? It's because she was having a rendezvous with another man. And so I told my father, as if it was any of my business, that my mother was cheating on him. And he said, cheating on me? And I said, yes, Dad, she's cheating on you with lots of men. And he said something I never thought he'd ever said. And I said, I guess I have to forgive her. And I was like, forgive her? Why don't we forget her? Do you know how much trouble she's caused us? And then he proceeded to tell me that when I was 6 months old, he worked out of the country. He sampled some of the local talent and he gave my mother an STD. My mother took me and my two older sisters straight up to her family from a poor farm in rural Pennsylvania. She was the seventh child of seven children. She was another mouth to feed. And when she went home to her parents told her, you made your bed, you need to lie in it. And they sent her right back down to alcoholism. I'm pretty sure her world wasn't the way it ought to be. So she finally comes back down. She decided that she had over 30 years of living in active alcoholism and she was done. Even though my dad had been sober for a very brief period of time, she was done. So my dad decided that he was going to go ahead and try to get her back, but she still wouldn't come. And she moved in with a man that she had spent less than 2 weeks in 30 years. And that's what we call an Al-Anon, a geographic cure. But one of the things that happened before she left is my dad told me very quickly, this house is going to fall apart. You're going to have to find a way to put yourself through school. You're going to have to get an apartment. You're going to have to pay for everything, your own car and everything. And so one thing I've always prided myself is being able to land on my feet with alcoholism. You know, I was kicked out of my house at 16 years old for no good reason. The reason why I was kicked out of my house is I stayed home from school to study for a test. I didn't think I could make an A on the test, because the opposite, if I would make anything less than an A on a test, then I would be punished severely. And either it was the terror of not making the grade or to take the risk and stay home to study and perform better. And what happened? I came home from school because I pretended like I went to school. I came home and all of my things were in trash bags on the curb of the street at 16 years old. And very quickly, my dad told me not to let the door hit me on the butt on the way out. And right there, I learned that he joined the enemy camp. That's the family disease of alcoholism. So when this house fell apart, I came home one day. I decided to start working two jobs because I had to put myself through college. I came home and there's like blue dots on not everything, but about 90% of things. And I look around and I said, what is this? What's happening? What is this? Because what happens to me growing up in the violence of an alcoholic family home, I basically plug my spiritual umbilical cord into a room or into a person and take the temperature of the room and I try to figure things out and determine whether or not I'm safe. So here I am trying to figure things out and force a solution. What's going on? What's going on? And then I realized that the blue dots were the things that mother wanted to take with her. And I wasn't one of them. And yet again, it was our January 2nd reading and our courage to change, going to the hardware store for bread, looking for attention, support, affirmation from someone who couldn't give it. And I just wanted to put a blue dot on my head and stand up against the wall. And I just started crying because I realized that I wasn't good enough. And so the last family meeting that we had, my mother was there. It was a little bit awkward. She brought her boyfriend. My parents are still married. And so my sister's there. She's the oldest, having the first grandchild. And my mother goes straight for the jugular. She says, why don't you go find yourself another mother? And I stood up and I looked in her face and I pointed my finger at her and I said, if you leave here today, you're going to die an old, lonely woman. No one's going to care about you. I'm never going to look after you. And I hope you drop dead. And my dad told me to shut up. And there was nothing ever said about it. Why? Because there's no communication or connection in an alcoholic family home. That family fell apart. The house was torn down. I don't even have one fork or spoon from that house. It was perfect foreshadowing because there was nothing, nothing worthwhile, not one memory worthwhile of that house ever to take with me in my life. Because I'm a competent imposter. You know, I used to think of myself of what you see is what you get unless you're looking for something else. And then I could be that person. And so what I became is a perfectionist, and I tried to basically be good enough, act good enough, earn the grades so that I can earn affection, attention, and love. But I didn't know what love was until I came into the rooms of Al-Anon. And so basically at the same time when this family fell apart, I had a moral decision to make. I found myself to be pregnant and I didn't know what to do about it. And as this family is falling apart, the house was not torn down, but the divorce is going on. I had three questions to ask myself, and they were, do I keep the baby in this crazy, violent, alcoholic situation? And I said, no, I can't do that. I could not do that to my worst enemy. The second question was, give the baby up for adoption at a chance of a life in a loving home? And I couldn't do that either, because I'd never give up anything that had a shot of love in me, because I had a God-shaped hole, and what I've always wanted in my life was to create something or an environment in which I could be loved and not invisible. And so the last choice I had was abortion, and that was the only choice I could make, because I couldn't see how I could survive, because I'm on my own. I'm a child lost in this world, not understanding. Why am I not worth spending Thanksgiving with? Why am I all alone on Christmas? Why do I not, like, what's happened to my family? And it fed the family disease of denial, keeping secrets in isolation. So I did that walk of shame. I had that abortion. I went through the protesters. It's the only walk of shame I've ever done. I've only dated three people in my life, and I married one of them. And I went through that process, and afterward I was in a room full of women who were just crying, and all I could think of was, get me out of here, get me out of here. Because I knew that day, if I made that decision, God was dead to me for the rest of my life, because I'm a smart person. Even though I wasn't going to church, and even though there was no religious ornamentation or evidence of any literature or books of religious substance in my home, I knew I broke the one commandment that you should never break, which is, thou shalt not kill. So before I came into Al-Anon, I had a sick cycle of self-hatred and self-abuse going on. I had this negative self-talk that was invested in me from a young child. And what I became, I was an emotional cripple. And so I didn't know that I had the family disease of alcoholism, that what I did, I became an actor playing a part, living a double life, page 73 in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. And so I wanted a major turning point in my life story happened. And what I will say is, yes, there's all kinds of absurd parts of my story, and there's all kinds of heavy parts of my story, but I want to encourage people to laugh, because if I have the courage to say parts of my story, one of four things have happened. God has either repaired it, replaced it, restored it, or recovered it. And so two people in my life meant something to me, my grandmother, my father's mother, and his sister. His sister died at age 38 of breast cancer. And I was going up to her funeral. I was working two jobs. I was going to school full time. I had zero life whatsoever, because I was trying to make it in this world. I had no one paying my bills. I had no soft place to fall. I was on my own, literally. And so I go to the funeral, a very heavy experience. But my friend said, hey, before you get on that red eye, come out with us. We're going to take you out to dinner. You're a nutcase. You've had a terrible week. So I went out to them with them. We went to dinner. We went to this little tiny bar. And I never went to bars because I never had any time or money. And so that night with my friends, there was this person bothering me next to me at the bar. And I said, and he kept bothering me. And I said, yeah, whatever, buddy. And he kept making these paper roses in the form of napkins and passing my way. And I said, oh, if you think you're so great, why don't you just make me a new one? And he said, I can. I make them in the studio of my house. And I said, all right, buddy, there are dozens of women that you could take home tonight, and I'm not one of them. So why don't you just scram? And he said, well, if you give me your number, I'll leave you alone. And if you think I talk fast now, I talked at least 10 times faster, because I really wasn't interested in giving him my number. Didn't occur to me to lie to him either. I said my number so fast, and he was on a bar stool. He was so drunk, he literally fell off the bar stool. His friends carried him away. I never thought I'd ever hear from him again. While I was gone, he called me 8 times, and I said to myself, why is he calling me? Because no one ever called me. I was the girl who looked at her shoes, and I had no self-esteem. I had no self-respect. I was just basically buried in this world trying to make something. I was trying to get letters behind my name with degrees. I was trying to look the part, dress the part, act the part, and be the part so that I could be wanted or loved. And so as it turns out, I should have known he was an alcoholic. He broke the first 6 dates at very last minute. And I told him, I said, you're a clown. I don't want to have anything to do with you. And he goes, give me another chance. And so I did. And my husband is absolutely funny. Now, you would think, you know, meet him in the bar. Isn't there a clue that he's an alcoholic? Well, here's the cunning, baffling part about alcoholism. My husband never drank like my father. There used to be an old AA speaker by the name of Father Martin. He's dead now. And he used to say, you identify an alcoholic by the one you know. Well, my dad was an everyday drinker, pass out drunk, and he was unattentive and unavailable by 6:30 p.m. Dad just was non-existent, right? He was drunk. And so my husband was our boyfriend at the time. He was a binge drinker. He could turn it on and turn it off. He was working on two master's degrees at the same time. And he would have stretches and days without drinking. And drinking is normal in college. And so I tried to convince myself, well, this doesn't seem to be a problem because everybody's doing it. And so my grandmother told me before she died, she said, just because that boy gives you a ring, don't you dare move to Texas. And of course, I moved to Texas. I said, Grandma, you're old-fashioned. You don't know what you're talking about. I've got to figure out. I need to fix things in place. I got to get my job. I got to figure out where I'm living. I got to figure out all these things. And really what that is evidence of is that I don't have a higher power that I can do business with because God is completely shut out of my life. So I moved to Texas. And as soon as I closed that moving room door, I knew that I was in trouble. My husband, well, he wasn't my husband quite yet, but he said, well, you know, tonight's Tuesday night. We got to go. I'm going to with the boys to here. And then of course, Wednesday night was another deal. And so was Thursday night. And I said, wait a minute, isn't this what we've all waited for? I'm here now. And then I tried to be patient and long suffering, but guess what? If you remove me from my support system, whatever minor thing, support system that I have in place, then my character defects, those weapons of mass destruction start to launch. When alcoholism entered my life in an epic fashion, because alcoholism is cunning, baffling, and powerful. It never slows down. It's progressive. So by the time I moved to Texas, I thoroughly realized how much trouble I was in. The problem is that the wedding invitations went out. What I didn't fail to say is once I closed the chapter on that door to my mother, I hadn't spoken to her in years. And so my mother said she wasn't going to come to my wedding. She didn't come to my college graduation. She wasn't present for the birth of any of my children. My mother married a man. She didn't tell any of her daughters that she got married because that's how my mother does business. She cuts us out of our life. So I had no connection or relationship with my mother. And here I am in Texas doing battle with alcoholism and I don't even know that I'm sick. And so these two fools got married in October of 2001. And these two fools are still married today. And neither one of us knew that we were marrying the family disease of alcoholism. I had the blueprint from being affected by the family disease, and he had the alcoholic gene. And so you would think with all the fighting that we had, we never called each other by our first names. We called each other by four-letter words that you can only fill in the blank and imagine. And so there was war in our family. But yet, one thing that I look back at my life, I see the blueprint of God, his fingerprints all over my life. Do you know the first friend that I made in the city of Dallas was a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous, and I didn't even know it. And she started hearing about all the craziness, the fighting, the arguing. She invited me to stay over her house. And she knew that, you know, it's funny how alcoholics can recognize other people in their tribe. And she said, do you know, have you ever thought about going to Al-Anon? And I said, no, I've never. What is it? And she told me. And I said, do you really think I need it? Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm tracking and stalking my husband. I'm filling up his voicemail. I'm trying to find him to the best of my ability at home. But he's out thinking about his drinking. And I'm sitting here trying to hunt him down. And I'm doing everything insane and getting angrier by the day. So she convinced me to go to Al-Anon, and I went to Al-Anon. In fact, she gave me the little itty bitty blue book of the Alcoholics Anonymous. It's the first 164 pages, and she encouraged me to read it because one of the things about alcoholism is to do whatever you can to learn about the disease. So I read the book, I liked it, I went to meetings, I didn't get a sponsor, and I didn't work the steps. Why? It's because of the fear of rejection, because I had been rejected all my life. The person that you saw on the outside was living a double life. And I was an absolute monster behind closed doors. And if only you knew, with I was as sick as my secrets. I couldn't let anybody into my world because I was so guarded. I let nobody into my life because of the fear of getting hurt again. So nobody knew all of me until, later on in the steps. So I liked what I heard. I wrote notes. My husband's drinking started tapering down, and I fell out of an Al-Anon. I fell out of Al-Anon completely. It didn't take me too long before I came back to Al-Anon on my knees. In fact, my first sponsor, her name was, she's been deceased for 20 years. Her name was Marcy White. And she used to say, if you didn't come to Al-Anon on your knees, don't, just wait a little while. You'll get there. Don't worry about it. And this is true. One thing that I realized coming into Al-Anon, why my relationships were so explosive. I didn't have a relationship with anybody. I had reactionships with everybody because I have no God of my understanding that I was reacting to the alcoholism or any other ism that was going on. And I was using my weapons of mass destruction in order to try to minimize the fear and the calamity in my life. I had no idea that I was stuck in a pattern for which I couldn't change on my own. You know, I tried to sponsor myself before I finally, came into Al-Anon and got a sponsor. And that's my ism. I sponsor myself. That's the best example of unskilled labor right there. Because how can you fix your mind with your mind? How can you avoid immense confusion? And so that didn't work. And that's one of the reasons why I fell out of Al-Anon, is because I couldn't get honest. And that's the principle behind step one. And so what finally brought me into the program is that this is a ridiculous story. So my husband is always having very important business meetings. This night it just so happened to be in a strip club. And so my husband, in the middle of this strip club, he was in the middle of a lap dance, and he just so happened to call his wife while he was sitting on his phone. So here he is calling me at like 2 o'clock in the morning. This is my timer. He's calling me at 2 o'clock in the morning, and I pick up the phone and I listen to it. I hear this music, bong, chicka, bong, bong. And I was like, what is that? What is that? And then I hear this woman talking to my husband, and she says, why don't we go to the back room? And he says, I don't want to go to the back room. And she said, why? And he goes, because I don't want to do it. And then she asked him this. She said, why don't you leave your wife? And he says, I don't want to leave your wife. And I was like, good boy. And she says, why? And he says, because I don't want to lose half my money. Wrong answer. Ask anybody, any woman on planet Earth who has a one-year-old at home, a baby, I don't want to lose half my money is totally the inappropriate and wrong answer. Okay. So here I am on the phone. He's sitting on his phone, and I'm on a 42-minute phone call, cursing him out in paragraph form. And he doesn't even know that I'm doing it. Now, who's the insane one? Okay. He finally figured out that he called his wife. He hung up his phone. I called him back. We did that dance. And I don't know where he was, maybe it was a half hour. He came home, but in that time, that adrenaline, all of that anger, all of that rage, all of that resentment of my lifetime, it just boiled out. And when he came home, I just beat the tarnation out of him. It wasn't a fair fight. Of course, it wasn't a fair fight, but I kicked him. I hit him. I just kept working him over until he would stay down. And the next morning when he came to, and this is a funny story. This is funny because my husband was a total blackout drinker. He would never remember what happened. Okay. Because once the man took the drink took the man, and he would have no clue as to what part of town, jail, wherever he was. Okay. He came to the next day. He remembered what happened. And I got in his face and I said, there are thousands of women that would trade places with me in the city of Dallas, and I'm not going to live this way anymore. But I had a problem. We had a trip to go see my mother. I was going to bring to her the golden child, and I was going to show her that she didn't break me. And my ego was very much in charge of this. So the trip was in a day or two. And I said, I got in his face and I said, you're going to come up and see mama with me. You're going to act like you love me. You're going to be nice to me. You're going to hug and kiss me. And then when we get home, we're going to get a divorce. To which he put his hands by his side and he was like, yes. Yes, yes, get me away from this nut. So we went to go see my mom. And being around my mother is like being around a cactus, It's like being in a room that someone hates you. And so I gave her a hug, and it was like, you could fit two or three people in between you. And the visit went reasonably well. We had other family around, so we had to act like we were nice to each other. And then we got home, and my husband, of course, had another important business meeting, not in a strip club, he's learning. But that night, my life changed. That night, he got a severe brain injury as a result of being physically assaulted in the bar. And he was physically assaulted. He was punched so hard, it broke his jaw. His head basically hit the concrete and he didn't brace his fall. And so he had a massive brain bleed. In fact, the neurologist thought he had been kicked in the head repeatedly. And so his midline of his brain shifted 7 millimeters, which is a death sentence. Less than 1% of all people survive that kind of injury. And so I got that call in the middle of the night that nobody ever wants to get. And so the only person I knew to call in the middle of the night was a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous. And so at this time it was a therapist and a double winner. And I said, Mickey, I don't know what to do. What do I do? And he basically told me to take a shower, get dressed, call your babysitter, go to the hospital, of which I did. I went to the hospital and I saw my husband. He was, before he had to go for emergency surgery, he was just laying on the gurney. He looked exactly like he always looked. He only had a tiny little split on his lip where he was punched. And I saw him wearing his wedding ring and I asked the doctor, should he be wearing that? And he said, no, you need to take that off. And as I took that wedding ring off, I said 4 little words that I hadn't said. And I don't think I've ever said those 4 little words, but they are, thy will be done. And then I released him with love. And I just said to myself, I mean, I am 30 years old. I have no emotional bandwidth to be able to deal with the enormity of the situation. And so I sit down and he made it through emergency surgery. They basically cut his skull open with a Black and Decker saw and they drained all the blood and they put a little shunt in there and put his skull back on, stitched him up. He was wearing a turban and he was in ICU for 9 days. Now you would think that that was my bottom. In fact, I asked the doctor and I said, doctor, I remember him doing this. The doctor was like this with his lab coat. I said, doctor, what can we expect in the next year? And he goes, oh, well, you can expect extreme emotional highs and lows. And I went, oh, because I was already living with Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. We were already having the insanity train in my house on a regular basis. And I couldn't even fathom it getting any worse than what it was. And so I'm just thinking, we're just going to get Humpty Dumpty back together again. We get him patched up from the ICU. We bring him home. That night, Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans. And guess what? That's not my bottom. I'm a long bottom Al-Anon. It takes a lot to bring me down because I've spent my life being bulletproof and being frozen so I don't have to feel anymore. So I basically just have an Al-Anon brownout. I don't even remember anything. I'm not living in the present moment. I'm living in crisis one all day long because I'm having 24-hour care for my husband, which was me. I wasn't taking care of myself in a 3-month period with my family living there. My husband lost nearly 100 pounds. He went from like 215 pounds all at 6 feet tall, all the way down to 128 pounds, fully dressed, shoes, wallet, everything on a scale. And he was slipping through my fingers. I had lost 30 pounds myself. I had no flesh in my face anymore to speak of. And basically, I was rowing his boat so hard, mine was sinking. Now, what was it? What was my breaking point? What was it finally that got me my attention and getting to Al-Anon? Well, my husband decided, as soon as he got his jaw unwired shut about 3 months later, that he stopped taking his seizure medication, which was against doctor's orders, so that he could drink again. He didn't tell me, but that's what he did. He flew out of town and he came back in the house and then I saw him. But yet I couldn't keep my mouth shut. I looked at him and because of my violence background, I can look at him and I took the temperature and I was like, have you been drinking? To which he said, no. And right there, I had the 3 C's. You didn't cause it. You can't control it. You can't cure it, but you can contribute to it. And I realized right then and there that I was so suicidal and depressed that I was investing every ounce of my life into him that I was losing my own. And I knew I needed to get into Al-Anon with a purple passion. In fact, my counselor said, I'm not going to see you anymore unless you're going to go to Al-Anon. Why aren't you going to Al-Anon? And I said, because I'm busy. And he says, yeah, I'm not going to see you unless you go. So I said, fine. So I went to Al-Anon and I, look, this is not a winning formula. I had the desperation of a drowning man. I knew I needed to get a sponsor. I knew I needed to work the steps. So I asked the first 5 people in Al-Anon in the meetings that I went to, and keep in mind, my iceberg was thawing out. Those frozen feelings were thawing out of a lifetime of abuse and violence and pain, okay? And so I was crying in meetings like this, and they would always pass the Kleenex my direction as soon as before I shared. And finally, I asked 5 people, I said, would you sponsor me? And this was the reaction of all 5 people, not at once, but different days. They went, oh, no, 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 no. And I did finally get someone to meet me for a coffee commitment, but guess what? They didn't show up for that coffee commitment. And my greatest fears were being realized, that fear of rejection. But what I will say is rejection is God's protection, because you don't want someone who has no time for you in these steps. And so I called up my double winner friend and I said, I'm so effed up, Al-Anon can't even handle me. And he said, you've got to get yourself a sponsor. And I recognized someone that I had met in the rooms for many years before. And she gave me a hug at my first meeting, and she held on to me a couple of minutes too long. And when she was an old lady, and I couldn't tell her no. And she held on to me, and I pushed her off of me, and I said, thank you very much. And I ran down the hall and I cried, because I recognized the one thing that I hadn't had in my life ever, and that was love. Someone to love me no matter what, someone to love me just because I was there as a member of Al-Anon. So I asked her to be my temporary sponsor, and she was my temporary sponsor for 10 years in this program, and she just recently died. And I'm telling you, I've been under new sponsorship, but I really felt like I lost my oxygen when she died. The grief was just overwhelming, because in this program, you know, I took a chance on her and she took a chance of me, and I never knew what I was going to get. And what I got was almost weapons grade relationship skills that have saved my life so that I can participate in relationships in a loving way. That's what she gave me. She gave me two things as soon as I met her. And she said, Catherine, you cannot access the joy unless you're willing to walk through the pain, because pain is the only knife sharp enough to cut through denial. If you've got one more plan, one more figure it out, God can only work in your surrender and powerlessness. And she pointed me into the step one. She said, Catherine, I want you to write a gratitude list and a powerlessness list every day. The powerlessness was the outward symbol of my inward desire to let go and let God into my life, because I had a problem with God. I had a prejudice of God. And you know what that was? If there was a God, why wasn't I worth saving? And so she turned me into step two. And so she snuck God into my back pocket, because she said, Catherine, everything that is good in your life is of God. And so I started to come to believe. And she started to ask me in step two to make a list of all the crazy and insane things that I was doing to control alcoholism, which I did. And she said, she suggested that I create an environment in which sanity and serenity are possible, where it can flourish. And what were some of those things she asked me? She asked me to mind my own business. Do you know there's two kinds of businesses, my business and none of my business? And anything outside of my hula hoop is none of my business. She also told me to stop asking questions that I know the answers to, such as, have you been drinking? Right? She also told me to stop answering statements. Just because my husband calls me a four-letter word or a chair or anything else doesn't mean that I am a chair, and to keep my mouth shut and start practicing restraint of pen and tongue. She also gave me the 5 G's in Al-Anon, which are get off of their back, get out of their way, get on with your life, get to meetings and give them to God. It's because the battle's not mine, it's God's. Because when I step aside and let God's will be done, I free myself from anxiety and a mistaken sense of responsibility that I'm supposed to live anybody else's life but my own. And that allowed me to turn to step three. She says, I want you to turn your will and your life over to the care of God in your marriage. She said, your husband is your greatest teacher to you if only you will surrender to the lesson. That I can do something, or just for today card says, I can do something for 24 hours that would appall me if I had to do it for a lifetime. And that allowed me to take a look at step four. Step four, writing that fearless and moral inventory. Let me tell you, I have never done anything fearless in my entire life. I've always run from people, pain, and problems. Fabulous skill set in a violent home as an adolescent. Horrible skill set in relationships. And so I wrote this inventory as if I was never going to show anyone, because I built a foundation of trust with the first three steps with this woman, and I was finally ready because of the pain in my life. It was cutting me so deeply. I had run my life in the ground. In fact, we just had a reading the other day that said, if you do what you've always done, you're going to get what you've always got. So I had that golden parachute. I wrote it as if I was never going to show it, and I didn't have to take that fifth step. So I finally, when I scheduled that appointment to meet, do that fifth step with her, that was the first courageous thing I ever done in my lifetime, when I pulled into her apartment garage and I knocked on her door, because I've always been a chicken my entire life. And then I sat down with her in the fifth step, and I had all those go into the grave secrets. I had all that toxic shame. I saved them all to the last, and I thought my fifth step can flip an 18-wheeler, but let me tell you, you're not going to surprise a well-sponsored sponsor. And so I started the last couple of ones, and I'd read them, and I'd look over at her, and she didn't even bat an eye. And I read another one, she didn't even bat an eye. And then one of them, she's like, are you still doing that today? And I said, no, not today. I went to a meeting, I did prayer meditation, and then I went to her house. That's what I did. And so she goes, I don't want you to do that anymore. And I said, okay. And one thing, the greatest gift she ever gave to me was love. Love stands for listen, overlook, value, and encourage. She listened to my fifth step. She overlooked my faults. She valued me as a human being. She didn't shame or guilt me. And she encouraged me to continue to work the steps, because what was being restored in my life was unity, love, trust, respect, intimacy, connection, communication, and vulnerability from this fifth step. This woman taught me how to love and trust people again. And if it wasn't for her, I know I'd be dead today. Because what we uncovered is I had an emotional illness, which is the fear or conviction that I'm unlovable. No matter who I am, no matter what I do, I'm not worthy of anybody's love. So I turned to destructive and unproductive ways of having these needs of love met, such as caretaking, conforming, people pleasing, and performing. That's why I do. Why do I do that? Because it sure does beat being rejected all my life. And I've been rejected by my mother and everybody else. And so she asked me to make a list of my assets. So using the formula, you spot it, you got it. Because I had a list, short list of 9 character defects I love to play with. When I get afraid and my God, my higher power is not big enough, I always turn to this pattern of character defects. And so she asked me to write my assets. And today I know I have 52 things, God-given talents, gifts, abilities that God gave to me, that she asked me to bring to the world. And she gave me this wonderful winning formula. And she said, Catherine, you know, you don't have to be that person anymore, because there's 3 people inside of you: who you used to be, the woman that you are today, and the woman that God created you to be. And with those assets and the rest of the steps, then I was going to be that person. And she gave me the formula, this wonderful Al-Anon algebraic formula, A plus B equals C. If A equals me, working these steps, being of service, reading my literature, going to meetings, sharing in meetings, and trying to be helpful to newcomers. B equals my sick alcoholic. C has no other choice but to improve for the better, because I'm changing, especially my attitudes. And so now with step 7, I can see how I've fallen short of the woman that God created me to be. And that 7th step prayer, God, I want you to have all of me, good and bad. It's so important that I know what the good is. So what are my 8 step lists? Let me tell you what my natural negative form of meditation is as a result of the family disease of alcoholism. When I wake up in the morning, the natural meditation, even after 15 years, I'll be 15 years old in this program next month, October 1st. My natural prayer meditation is self-hatred, self-loathing, self-judgment, self-criticism, self-deception, and self-sabotage. That's what I do. I give up. My recovery triangle, it's not God first, me second, others third. I flip it upside down. Everybody else first. There's never any time for me, and there's zero time for God. And I gave away every piece of myself. And when I do that today, and I don't take care of myself, I have to use my character defects of keeping score, judging, criticizing, and looking to the outside world so that I can be okay. I know that about myself. So this program teaches me to take responsibility, because I have a 4-part disease: spiritual, mental, emotional, and physical. And it's my job to practice self-love, self-care, self-acceptance, self-forgiveness, and self-awareness. And that's really a gift that this program has given me. So how do I know, going into step 9, how do I know this program works? My sponsor first told me, she said, Catherine, I want you to give your husband a kiss hello and a kiss goodbye every single day. And so I started to do that. And my husband, he did not want to be hugged, nor did he want to be kissed. Because remember, we were fighting like dogs and cats. I'd already told him I wanted a divorce, right? So the first time I did it, I said, let me give you a hug and kiss. And he says, why? Kind of like what I told my sponsor, why should I give my husband a hug and a kiss? And she says, Catherine, that's what people do when they love one another. And I said, oh, keep in mind my family of origin, that wasn't happening. So it was new information for me. So I gave my husband a hug and kiss, and there was 2 people that could have fit in between the 2 of us. And when I tried to kiss his cheek, he tried to take his head off of his shoulders. And it was hysterical. But every single day I started to practice that tradition. And I started to, what happened is that love, that intimacy, and that trust and the communication and connection was being restored in our life. Also, well, I had to set boundaries with them because I told them, I said, hey, I don't want to get in the way of your drinking. You can drink where you want, when you want, however you want, but could you please sleep in the spare bedroom? And he said, I'd be happy to, because one of us had to be a parent the next day. And so he went out drinking. And then finally his drinking started to progress and I started to get afraid. And my sponsor said, Catherine, why don't you, instead of manipulate through anger, why don't you self-advocate and just ask him to get an insurance policy? And so I said, hun, listen, I don't want to get in the way of your drinking, but could you please get an insurance policy that would have a little money for college education for our son and pay off the house? And he said, I'd be happy to. And the relationship started, the trust and the tenderness started to come into place. And then one night he comes home and it's funny. He said, Catherine, you know, I know what my problem is. And I said, what is that, babe? And he says, my problem is whiskey and Coke. And I said, oh? And he said, I'm going to start drinking vodka and Diet Coke because it's healthier for me. And I said, oh, I can dig it. Because let me tell you, I had gotten a life and I had gotten off his back. And suddenly his rationale about whether or not his drinking is working for him, I knew that that was up to him because it's a full-time job getting to know me and taking my inventory. And it didn't bother me anymore. And I didn't have to say, you fool, did you just hear you were switching from one form of alcohol to another? I didn't have to tell them. And one thing I will share, the beauty of this program is when you get a useful and productive life in service and focusing on your own life and building a constructive life, you are less likely to take over other people's lives. And they don't need to be sober in order to be happy, joyous, and free. And that's been the greatest gift of this program. So finally, my husband comes home one night and he comes in the room and he woke me up. And normally he didn't do that. He said, listen, I'm sorry I woke you up, but I just wanted to let you know I was home. And that showed me it was courtesy, you know? And I said, yeah, no problem. And he lingered at the edge of the bed. And I said, is everything okay? And he said, Catherine, I have something to tell you. And I said, what is that? And he said, I think we both know that I'm an alcoholic. And thank God I learned to listen in Al-Anon and I didn't crosstalk on his share. And he said, I would like to ask, would you be my sponsor? And I said, I can't be your sponsor. And he said, why? And I said, because I don't know what it's like to need or want to drink. I said, can I get you a number? And he said, yeah, you can get me a number, but I'm not ready to do what you do. And I understood that because I had been an Al-Anon retread, that the pain had to get so bad before I was willing to do something different. My husband, in short, he did get to Alcoholics Anonymous. Let's just say he got a nudge from the judge that he had to get. He had a parole officer and basically all the DWIs he got. He never was convicted, but he finally had his last one that ran, you know, basically everything ran together and they said, you know, you're going to be on probation. And so he was in court order day A. He was in the computer and had to get his paper signed. But you know what? He decided that AA wasn't for him. And you know, who am I to say that God's not big enough that that doesn't work? And one thing I know that's true in our literature, when one person in the family changes, the whole nature of the family changes. And so many of you ask about mother. What happened with mother? Well, many of you would be surprised that my mother is my best friend today. And how that came about was I had no relationship with my mother whatsoever. And at the second year in recovery, all this anger and rage started to come up because my mother-in-law was treating me like my mother. And I have an unbelievable ability to dissociate and detach and really deny the painful history of my past. But I do believe that God, he gives us the gift of denial because I couldn't have faced the violence and active alcoholism at the same time. And that came in subsequent years. In fact, the funny part, denial stands for didn't even notice I am lying. Because when my sponsor asked me, hey, you haven't mentioned anything about your parents or, you know, your mom. And I said, well, you know, we haven't spoken in a couple years and we haven't fought in a long time. I guess everything's okay. And I really did mean it. So we went through the fourth and fifth steps and she asked me to write a list of assets for my mother. And I did. And then she asked me to come up with a list of qualities that a daughter would be. I said, well, I'd probably have connection with her, probably call her once a week, probably write cards, send gifts on time. And then she said, okay, we'll work with that. And I said, work with what? And she said, we'll work with that. And I said, what do you mean? She goes, I want you to call your mom and tell her you love her. And it's like, I'm not doing that. And she said, why? I said, because I won't do it. And she was on the phone and she said, well, Catherine, I just don't know how you're going to do it, but you're just going to have to find a way. Bye. And I'm telling you, I was so mad at my sponsor and I was marching around in my kitchen and I said, I am never going to call Nina anymore. That is my solution. I am never going to call her.
Did she not hear my fifth step? And suddenly, as I was marching around and this anger was coming up and self-pity and all this denial and all this, you know, I'm just looking for an audience, right? And I was by myself. And finally, the idea came. I'm going to call my mother and tell her I love her because it's going to hurt her. And that's the only reason why I picked the phone. So I pick up the phone and I call my mother. And my mother hates everybody. And her name means sea of bitterness, by the way. And so I call my mother and she went on for 30 minutes about taking the whole city's inventory, all the neighbors, everybody you can imagine, and gossiping. And so finally she's like, well, I'm about done. And I said, wait, Ma, I have something to tell you. And she said, what? And I said, I love you. And she hung up on me. And let me tell you, it was the greatest day of my life. If I knew calling my mother would tell her, would hurt her, I would have done it 20 years ago. I would have picked up the phone every day and say, hey, Mom, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you, clown, and hung up on her. You know, I would have done that. But this is a counterintuitive program. And so my sponsor gave me specific direction on how to do it. And the hardest part for me was writing cards. How do you write cards to someone that's hated you all your life? And so she would suggest that I'd go to the store. Back then, we didn't have smartphones. And I would copy verbatim what's in another card in the card, and I would send it. And that's what I did. And it's the repetition that strengthens and confirms until habit becomes natural. Why? Because I can't think my way into right acting. I act my way into right thinking. And every action of love, every time I called her, every kindness that I invested in that relationship, God was healing from me on the inside out. And why is that? It came down to, do I want to be right or I want to be happy? Because I was losing my program of recovery being right. And I was being a victim, a villain, and a volunteer. I was a victim of this disease many years ago. I was a volunteer trying to get my mom back and pass on the pain. And I was a villain making sure that her every day was miserable. And I was losing my spiritual awakening because I wanted to get even. That's that road to revenge. And the thing is when I stepped aside from that self-pity and that self-hatred and wanting to pay forward the pain, somebody in my home group said, Catherine, when is a tennis match over? And I was like, I don't know, Pat, help me solve the puzzle. And she said, it's when someone stops hitting the ball over the net. And when I stopped feeding the pain of the family disease of alcoholism, my mother could count on one thing that I would hurt her. I was no longer going to be part of passing on the disease. And I focused on loving her. And a lot of people have said to me over the years, but I have nothing to say to my mother. Well, what I was doing in the fundamental, you know, I could only buy Mom the funny fart cards in the beginning, you know, because we had nothing there. But one thing I was able to find, Mom, thank you for being the Easter Bunny, Santa Claus, and the Tooth Fairy. And that was my new beginning. And what God had done, it wasn't the phone calls when Mom finally graduated to I love you. That wasn't the moment. But there was a moment. My second child was born. Of course, my mother wasn't part of it. But she came down when he was about 3 months old. And she met him. And she was with my stepdad. And we had a decent visit. It's because I was practicing this program as if I still was drowning, you know, because I loved everything I was getting out of it. And so when I took her to the airport, I came home. I was by myself. And I sat down. And I realized in this moment, I realized this wave of emotion started to wash over me. And I know when hostile or any kind of emotion washes over me, I know to get still. And I got still and I said, God, what is this? What is this? And I realized in that moment, I missed my mom and she was gone. I used to pray that she'd get out of my face. And I used to pray that she'd drop dead. And in that moment, I missed my mom and she was gone. And one of the things my first sponsor asked me to do when I was new in the program was read the 9-step promises on pages 83 and 84. And it says in the end, are these extravagant promises? We think not. They are being fulfilled among us sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly. But they will always materialize if you work for them. You know, coming to meetings, sitting and listening. But I won't build a program of recovery, but getting a sponsor, working the steps and being of service, that has been my saving grace because now I have an Al-Anon prescription in order to thrive in relationships, not survive, but to thrive. So I know we're about end of time, but I want to close with a couple of things that I like to use on a daily basis. You know, my 10th step, I have learned that I take my inventory and not other people. Why? Because I can't change anybody else. And I've had a lot of writing to focus on myself up to this point. And when I find things such as anxiety, worry, and fear. When I find anxiety is like repeatedly experiencing failure in advance. And worry is like putting a down payment on a problem you're never going to have. Because worry is like a rocking chair. It keeps you busy, but it gets you nowhere. And so there's another saying I love in Al-Anon. In one of our pamphlets, it says, if you pray, why worry? If you worry, why pray? because every good thought is a prayer. So I switched the topic in step 11 and I bring my problems to my higher power. And if my problems had brought me to prayer, they have served its purpose. And so that brings me to step 12. You know, my dad recently got sober. And he was the only reason why he had to do that was because he had to have major open heart surgery and they wouldn't operate on him. And my dad asked for me to take care of him. My dad gave up alcohol. He gave it up on Lent again, y'all. He gave up alcohol one beer at a time. My dad used to start drinking at 10 a.m. and he'd drink a case of beer a day. But he's sober today without a program of recovery. But who am I to say that that's wrong? It's not wrong because this program's taught me to focus on our 4L slogans. Live and let live, let go and let God, listen and learn, and let it begin with me. Because the greatest thing I can do is practice the strength that you guys have given me. I really believe that all these steps boil down to love. And love stands for, here's another one for y'all, let others voluntarily evolve. And this program gives me the strength to detach. And detach stands for don't even think about changing him or her. You know, this program taught me to be the best example of the big book that I can be because I'm the only copy that my husband or my father ever saw. And it wasn't my manipulation or involvement in their life for them to get sober, that they had their own coming to the moment where their drinking no longer was working for them. And that is a testament to the love of this program. And so one of my favorite quotes, it was just cross-quoted in our Courage to Change about last week, but it originally comes from our One Day at a Time book on page 165. And it's a quote from Thomas Merton, "No man is an island." And it says, "The beginning of love is to let those we love be perfectly themselves and not twist them to fit our own image. Otherwise, we only love that vision or version of ourselves that we see in them." This program teaches me that what is not transformed in the steps will be transmitted. And that is the urgency that I have with my own children. I have skill sets to raise my own children. I have an 11-year-old and 16-year-old. And it is an absolute joy to be able to be the observer of my family and not absorb it, okay? That is, I don't need to react. And one of the favorite slogans I have is to not show up to every fight that I'm invited to. What a gift that I can just sit there and watch it pass on by, that I don't have to make a big deal over everything. And it's been the greatest gift this program has given me to pass on to my family and to you all. So I'm going to close with my favorite prayer. I love this prayer. I heard an AA speaker share it in Australia about 10, 15 years ago, and I've never forgotten it. And I'd love to share it with you. And the prayer is, "I am the place where God shines through. For God and I are one, not two. God loves me just and as I am. I need not worry, fret, nor plan. And if I stay where God wants me to be, he will work his plan through me." Thank you very much. And I do want to say to everyone on this call, if no one's told you they loved you today, I do. God bless you.